another scripture I had ready, but while we were singing, it just kept, I kept coming over to my spirit what Isaiah said in chapter 53 when he said, "Who hath believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?" Goes on and says, "He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." We are healed. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. As we go before the Lord this morning, we want to take a moment to pray, to ask God to be with those who are sick and going through difficult seasons. I see that Sister Elsie Murphy is here with us in service today. Sister Elsie, we love you. This entire church suffered a great loss here in this life this last week with the passing of Brother Ralph Murphy. He was chairman of the council, chairman of the two different building committees. He was a usher. He was a director of the senior adult choir. He served on just about everything you can serve as a man, and yet he was humble and broken and loved the Lord with all of his heart. He went home to be with the Lord this week, and I'm telling you, it's just been a time of just reflection and so many beautiful and wonderful stories about him. Today, we honor him with some of the flowers that are here from his memorial service. And we just want you to know, Karen, it's great to see you as well. Sister Murphy, we love you. And we are your church, and we're praying for you. And we know that you're going to be all right, because he is right now in the presence of the Lord. And God will sustain you and keep you. And not to mention, we'll put our arms around you as well. We love you very much. As we go before the Lord in prayer, we want to ask him to minister the different needs that are here. I noticed that Sister Debbie Williams and Sister Evelyn is back here tonight, today, this morning. God bless you ladies for being here. They suffered the loss, as you know. We talked about Sister Jewel Buell that went on to be with the Lord as well. You know, there, I agree with some folks that have said it's getting to the point where there's more folks I love over there than they are over here. How many have found that to be true in your life? There's a lot of folks over there. There's a lot more to go to heaven for. But I tell you, they're shouting and celebrating there, and they're getting ready for us. Because how many of you know Jesus is coming soon? He's coming soon. Amen. Praise God. I love what Sister Karen said over her father, or over her grandfather's funeral. She said, "You know, I just feel in my heart that it won't be a long separation. Just a little while, and we'll all be together again." We're going to go before the Lord in prayer, knowing that he is our deliverer, he is our provider, our healer. I see several of you. You're smiling today. God's touched you, blessed you. There's miracles in this house this morning. We have folks that have been healed of cancer right here in this congregation. People that have felt the presence of God. Well, I'm going to tell you, the pastor got healed a couple Sundays ago, right in his back. Amen. The awesome thing about God, I haven't had one bit of pain since then. I keep looking up and just going, wow, he's awesome. You know, he's a healer, and he can heal you today. So if you have a need today, would you make it known with an uplifted hand all over this congregation? Amen. Let's pray together. Father, as we come before you, we thank you that in your word you declared you want us to bring every care to you. We thank you for, as we sang about the blood of Jesus, that same blood was the sacrifice for our not only salvation, but, oh Lord, you added healing. You added deliverance, and we thank you for that this morning. We bring to you every care and every concern in this congregation, our families, our extended families and friends, God, all around this world, our missionaries that we're praying for. We just lift them all up to you and ask you to minister your grace, your love, your presence, your power. God, we love you and we honor you. We know that those things we commit to you, that's the best hands they can be in. For you promised in your word, those things we commit to you, you'll take care of. We ask you to heal today. We ask you to deliver. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Be with those who have lost loved ones who are on the other side of glory this morning. Touch them, strengthen them, and be with them a comfort during difficult days. As we give you praise and honor, we ask all of these things to your glory in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Now that we have you seated, I'd like to recognize, I understand we have a minister here with us today, Brother Billy Collins. Are you here? Would you stand, please? We would like to honor you. He has been a pastor in our state, a minister with us today. God bless you. When I first heard Billy Collins, you know, Jeff was telling me, I thought, well, I know Brother Collins, but I think he went on to be with the Lord. There's a Billy Collins and his son, and we're glad that you're with us today. That's a man that's standing on the streets of glory this morning, isn't he? Great man of God. Our encounter is in the throes of being finished with our ladies' encounters. There's a bunch of them out there. They've been sending reports that ladies have been filled with the Holy Spirit. They've been delivered. They've been touched. And they're on fire, ready to come back. So it'll be awesome. Our ushers are coming to serve you today. And as they do, we would remind you that all the loose offering will go to our missionary work all around the world. And of course, as you give to pay your tithes, that goes to the ministries here in our local body in the Stratford Heights Church. Just ask you to give today as the Lord has blessed you. And God promises that He will return every gift. He always blesses His people. Lord, as we come before you, we thank you. We honor you today. We ask you especially to touch the missionary work around the world. We ask as our missionaries are being hard at work today, Father, they're ending their day in a lot of the places where we love and support and pray. We just ask you to bless them, comfort them, and use us today to minister to their needs. God, if we can be used, if we can just meet a need that they have with the ministry there, Lord, that's a blessing and an honor for us. Touch your people today as we give. Lord, those who have come prepared and ready to pay their tithes, we thank you for those gifts. We thank you for those who are obedient to your word. That keeps the ministries here going to your honor and to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I was ready for them to go all over again. Stand with me this morning. How many of you got that down inside your heart this morning? God has taken care of you. Can you lift a hand to honor and to praise Him, to give Him glory? He is an on-time God. Hallelujah. I feel that down inside my heart this morning. There have been lots of times when I've needed Him. And you know what? I can testify to you this morning. He has never let me down. He has always been there for me. I have been times through the valleys. And I've been other times on the mountaintop. But I have found that He's always there, no matter what. He is an on-time, every-time God. Amen. How many have found Him to be there in your life? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, if I had half a voice, I'd just kick off and start singing. Lucky for you, I'm hoarse. As you're standing for the reading of God's Word, title this message, Let's Go to Church. Let's go to church. See that Sister Olinger is here as well this morning. God bless you. We know that you've suffered quite a loss with Brother Worley. Your church loves you. We appreciate you being strong and being here today. Remember these folks to pray for them. Precious lady, she's very quiet, very unassuming. Just sits back there and don't say very much, but we love you. We know that you're going through a difficult season. God bless you. Luke chapter 18 and verse 9. Let's go to church. How should we go to church? Jesus considered it pretty important to pretty much stop everything. He had to tell something to the church. We're going to hear that message this morning. Luke chapter 18 and verse 9. And he spake, meaning Jesus, this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves. Key to that verse right there. Which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men, Jesus said, went up into the temple to pray. The one a Pharisee, and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. Says, I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And as he rambled on, continuing his long, drawn-out prayer. Verse 13, the Bible says, "And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner." I tell you, Jesus said, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that will exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Let's pray. Our Father, maker of the sun, the moon, and the stars, you've given to each of us life. When the world would brand us, label us, or discard us, reject us, you have called us to mercy. Save us, O Lord, from ourselves. Wash us in the truth that sets us free. Anoint every man, every woman, every boy and girl that's here today. Anoint your word that is spoken, every person to receive it. And Lord, save some, deliver many, be merciful to all. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said amen. Before you're seated today, I want to tell you that the jail ministry met yesterday, and they said 12 men and 3 ladies came to Jesus Christ in our jail ministry. Isn't that wonderful? Amen. You may be seated. What a privilege it is for all of us this morning to be in the house of God. Do you understand what an honor that it is for you and I to be here? To be in the right mind, to know that we need to be in God's house on a Sunday morning? Most of you cleaned up pretty good. You got in your vehicles and you headed off to the house of the Lord. What a privilege and what an honor. What a blessing in our lives. You know, I talked in the 8:30 service and we were singing, "I Am Blessed." And as they were singing it, I remember I used to have quite a testimony. I felt good about it. I said, "Lord," one day it just dawned on me, "man, look how blessed I am. Man, I have been so blessed, Lord. Where others have to fight through so many different barriers in their life, Lord, I was blessed. I was put in a Christian home with a godly mother and father. My family, everyone loved the Lord. We went to church. We were not only just churchgoers, we were Pentecostal churchgoers. I thought, man, I had a head start against so many other folks in this life." And I used to think about, wow, you know, I'm so glad I wasn't born in some cave somewhere in Afghanistan where I was serving some unknown god or some false god and had to literally find my way from the dredges of the third world country and moving through false religion to try to get to God. And I used to be real thankful about that. And I used to, you know, tell everyone, "I'm so thankful, God, you know, I wasn't born in a Satanist family, or I wasn't born in, you know, in all these different situations you can be in." But I had the Lord to speak to me something so awesome the other day. I was once again kind of being thankful. And I said, "Lord, thank you so much that I wasn't born in one of those caves over there in Afghanistan." There's news was showing the reports of the families living there and hiding in those caves. And I thought, wow, I'm not serving, you know, a false religion or a false god. And I didn't have to go through that. I said, "Thank you, Lord, for that." And the Lord spoke something to my heart. I knew it was him because I wasn't thinking anything like this. He spoke to me and he said, "You know, I can find you in the cave just as well." Amen. If you had been in the cave, I'd have still loved you. I'd have still found you. Isn't it wonderful to know there are no barriers, no boundaries to God's love? We sing about the love of God, and it truly is wonderful, miraculous, and amazing how God loves you and I. He will reach down through whatever he's got to reach through. The Bible, there's an old song that used to sing around here. It says, "When he reached down his hand for me, he had to reach way down." For some of us, he had to reach way down. I think for all of us, he had to reach way down. There's nothing more an enemy to the Spirit of God's work in our lives than mere humanity, the natural order of man. But I'm telling you, I'm thankful that it doesn't matter how far down Jesus had to reach, he has got more than enough strength to pull us up. Amen? God is good, and he's good even in the caves. This scripture that we are reading today, this passage of scripture, was You have to read it all in context. You have to go back and look at all that the scripture was saying there in that context where Jesus was moving literally from city to city. And it started off in that chapter 18 with Jesus finding as he was coming near a city gate that there were 10 lepers that were standing by. They were calling out to him, asking for healing. And Jesus, here he was in this public ministry, and he's doing what God has sent him to do, and all of heaven is very aware of what's happening, and Jesus is moving in and out of the little towns, and he comes up on this gate, and here's these 10 folks, and they call out for healing, and Jesus says, as you go, you'll be healed, you'll be cleansed. And boy, they turn and hightail it out of there. He says, go show yourselves to the priest. And the Bible says, as they were going, as they were leaving, as they walked, the healing began, the cleansing came. And they, by the time they got into town, they were cheering and screaming. They were allowed to go places that they weren't allowed to go before. They had literally had to call out unclean everywhere they went. They couldn't go to the local market. They couldn't visit a lot of places. They couldn't go in the temple. There was places they couldn't be. Now they were completely restored, and they took off a flying into town. But one of them stopped dead in his tracks when he saw what had happened. He remembered the pain. He remembered the hurt. He remembered all that he had been through. And when he saw that his hands were as soft as a baby, he turned back around and he came back to Jesus. And he said, Lord, I glorify you. I praise you. Thank you. And Jesus looked at the situation and he began to get an understanding of where the state of the church was. Of the church. He looked and he said, were there not 10 of you, but only one has found his way back to give thanks? And Jesus began on a journey, and he left there, and as he left that situation and he started seeing, you know, a man, people, you know, I guess he probably rationalized, well, they're excited, and maybe, you know, when they'll think about it, or he knows all things, he probably knew exactly what they were thinking. He moves from there and he finds himself, they tell me I pick on Frisch's too much, so I'm not going to pick on Frisch's. They got a great salad bar. Go visit them. Leave a good tip. So Jesus happens by Applebee's on a Sunday night after church, and he sees all the church people there, just table after table. And the Bible says that Jesus, as he went on his way, he found the Pharisees, the church. And it says immediately they started testing him, trying to trap him, trick him. They started asking all kinds of questions about the kingdom. And Jesus began to tell them. He was grieved in his heart. He's like, you know, I just left a scene where I healed 10 lepers and only one said thank you. And now I run into the church folks and they're all testing me. They don't believe anything that I'm saying. They don't even believe who I am. And he begins to tell them, but not before he's thought about what's going on. These were the folks that should have recognized him. These were the people that knew he was coming. They were the ones that for generations of years had taught their little children why the little boys dreamed of a king that was coming, and the little girls would go back to Isaiah's writings and they knew about a prince of peace. They thought all their dreams were going to come true. Every night they would pray their prayers and probably would many times gathered around their parents would pray for the Messiah to come. They were looking for him. They knew the prophecies. They knew that he was going to come through a little town in Bethlehem. They knew how he was going to come. And they even at this point in the story, they even knew how he had come. And how the rumors had spread that he had been the star and the shepherds and the kings and Herod and all of these things. They knew those things. They knew the stories. But yet the church still rejected him. They had heard at 12 years old, he happened by the temple and was talking with the priests and teaching. And they still closed their ears and would not hear. Closed their eyes and would not see. I thought about that as I listened to that song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. You know, it takes a supernatural experience to come to Christ. It isn't something you can just decide any old time you want to. The Holy Spirit, it comes to you, and the invitation is given from heaven and from the sacrifice. And then you are given that opportunity, that honor to receive him. And that's the only way. The Bible says, Jesus said, no man comes to the Father except the Spirit draws him. It's an invitation from heaven. And here in this situation, this passage of Scripture, you see Jesus grieved in his heart. He's grieved because he knows, he senses, the church is not ready. They're not recognizing me. They don't even know who I am. I'm the Messiah. I was the promise. I remember my last night in heaven. He could be thinking about all of the grand, you know, I'm sure there was quite a farewell for him in heaven as David and Moses and Joshua and Abraham make their times to go by and speak with him, and all the prophets. I can see Ruth, you know, standing in the back of the crowd and thinking about Boaz and handfuls on purpose. You can think of all the things that he represented and all that he knew, and heaven knew the angels by the thousands were standing ready on guard should he just look up to them and call them out. Just one look, an invitation for them to rescue him from the mission of this earth. And boy, they were ready. They were ready to come. The Bible says he could have called them at any time and they would have come. And heaven would have celebrated. Heaven would have went right back to being the beautiful paradise that it was. Worship of God and no sin in heaven. But the love of God that reaches so deep into the hearts and minds of the church, of men, the believers. So important that we guard and watch ourselves today, especially in these hours, because you see, we're a lot like the generations that were looking for the Messiah. We're looking for him again, Brother Ron. We're looking for the Messiah. We tell our children, we tell them every night before we say our prayers, now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, pray the Lord my soul to take. We pray the prayers. We tell them about a trumpet. We tell them about the angels, the eastern sky. We make promises about Jesus coming back again, and we tell it and we live it and we breathe it and we look for him just like they did. But as I am seeing the coming of the Lord is getting closer and closer and closer, I'm seeing a parallel, Brother Robinson, that's too much like what I've read in the Word. We're once again scoffing. We're once again rejecting. And we're once again not recognizing him. Will we know when he comes? Will we really know? Will the church hear the trumpet? Will the church cheer and yell as we're all brought together with the sound of the trumpet and the dead in Christ? Are we going to even know? Will half the church even know? Where are we? Jesus grieved in his spirit. He looked at those Pharisees that were testing him that day and he said, remember Lot's wife. Remember what happened. Remember what happens when you look away, when you look back, when you go back to the beggarly elements. You're believers. You believe in God. You believe in his word, his promises. Hold to those truths. It was Paul that told Timothy, hold fast your profession of faith. Don't allow anything to keep you from being real, being connected, being sold out to God. God's been doing great things in our church. We're growing. It's so wonderful. 20 folks, they said, got filled with the Holy Ghost last Sunday night. Isn't that amazing? God's so good. I remember at one time the power of God was moving in this altar and everyone that was being prayed for was just getting filled with the Holy Ghost instantly, just like that. It was amazing to see the people that got healed, the people over in the corner that got saved. It was just a wonderful service. It was the power of God. I'm telling you, the Messiah is coming again. He's on his way. He's getting his bride ready and he's looking for a spotless, without wrinkle bride that's looking for his coming. And when he comes, there's going to be jubilee. There's going to be celebration and there will be those. I know some of you. I know Sister Elsie has got a whole lot to go to heaven for. She'll be ready. I know she'll hear that trumpet. I see many of you out here. You'll hear that trumpet. But my question is to the church, are we really ready for his coming? Will we recognize him when he comes? They didn't recognize him then. His eyes, his voice. There's anyone who knows me knows I'll say this, and I say it periodically. To me, one of the greatest things about getting to heaven will be to hear what his voice sounds like. To hear him call my name. And there is only one first conversation I want with Jesus. I am not interested in, hello, how are you doing? Oh, that's a nice tree. All I want to hear, Regina, is I want to hear him look at me and say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. After I hear that, boy, then it's all, I want to see everything. I want to find everybody. I want to know what it's all about. But I want to hear those words. I want to know that I love him now. I want to know when I get to heaven that I'm going to be welcomed with open arms by a Savior who knows my name. It's important that your name is known in heaven this morning. It's not necessarily important that you grace the rolls in the attendance of churches or of any kind of community organizations. It's not necessarily important you get all kinds of rewards and honors in this life. I'm telling you, the greatest reward and the most important thing you have going in your life is to hear your name called on a roll that's up yonder. You hear your name called by Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Why couldn't they feel him? Why couldn't they sense when he stood in their presence? This was Jesus Christ. This was the Son of God. When they heard him speaking, when he was telling the stories, when he was instructing them, when he was telling them, remember Lot's wife. Why was there not burning conviction down in their hearts? This was the Son of God. But they were so cold and so indifferent. And may I say, I sense and I feel the church is in the same place today. We've got to be on guard and we've got to be careful. We've got to make sure that our ears and our spirits are in tune with God Almighty. It's so important that you and I know him when he comes. The irony of it all, the tragedy of it all, Jesus walking into town, walking into the synagogue, walking into the church house. I like to think that if he materialized physically for us, manifested his presence here in this house today and walked down the middle aisle, I'd be able to know exactly who he was. I would want to know that. Jesus looking at the church, looking at the pews, and thinking, wow, back to the wilderness for my church. Back to the wilderness. Back to a time when they didn't know what they really wanted. Should we go back to Egypt? Should we go back to the world? Isn't this all just a little much? I mean, isn't it like, shouldn't we have balance in our life? I mean, the church is good and ministry's good. Loving Jesus, reading your Bible, praying, that's all good and stuff. But you know, we have a well-rounded life here. We need to balance it all out. All I know is that Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven in all of his righteousness, and then everything else will come. There's nothing more important than your relationship with Jesus. There's nothing more important than you making sure he's your morning, he's your noon, and he's your night. There's nothing more important than making sure, like that song says, I surrender all to him, all to him. Given everything that you have, but Jesus saw the need in the church. He saw the unthankfulness. He saw what people can do to one another. He saw, as the Son of God, what the church was doing to him. And so it's no wonder. Can I speak to a church that's growing this morning? Can I speak to a church that people are getting saved and our ministries are growing? We have no room. The Christian education department's about to pull their hair out because we can't add new classes, and we're doubling and stacking some of our hours on Wednesday, and we're trying to move some to Tuesday night because we got so many folks wanting to have a class and people wanting to be involved in small groups and ministry. Isn't it a good problem to have? But at the same time, my question to us is, are we being careful that we are not hurting? That in all of this great work that God is trusting us with, because you know, a church won't grow. A church doesn't grow. People don't get saved and filled with the Holy Ghost if God isn't trusting you. He'll send people to you if he can trust you. And I pray every day that our ministers are humble and broken and poured out before God and filled with Him. I love a choir, but I don't want a choir that just sings good. I want a choir that brings the presence of God down. I don't want preachers in our pulpits that just preach. I don't want good speakers. I want people that are called of God, filled with the Spirit of God, to where conviction of the Holy Ghost is in the house. That's what I want. I want to make sure that we're a church like Jesus wanted us to be. And I'm determined as good as I can be, because you see, back then and there, they had an ideal that they would persecute Him. They had an ideal that they would hate Him and despise Him and reject Him. If you've ever felt that way from the church, I want to speak to the hurting today. I want to speak to sheep that have been wounded. If you've ever been in a church where some of these good spiritual folks, these Pharisees, had hurt you and wounded you and judged you and rejected you and turned their back on you and walked away from you. Let me just say, Jesus felt the same way from the same kind of church. And it wasn't something that ever reflected Him. As a matter of fact, He said, "It's not me." I'll tell you, there's two people that went to that temple that day. And Jesus was making it clear. He said, one was one of these super spiritual, self-righteous people who got out in the middle of everything and wanted to be seen of men. I'm telling you, it's important that you and I listen to what Jesus was saying. He said He was right out there on the middle of the they didn't have a street, I guess, concrete. And He's out there and He's praying His prayer and He's saying, I fast twice in the week. I pray three times a day as a devout Jew. I give of all of my possessions tithes. I do this and I do that and I do this. And Lord, I'm so thankful I'm not like all those extortioners and all those murderers and all those sinners and even like this publican. This publican who's standing far back praying himself. That gave you a sign. That lets you know that this was a problem in the church. This publican is praying. And this spiritual man, you know, the Pharisees were the teachers. They were the spiritual folks. They were the ones sold out. They were the ones that most respected. They were spiritual authority in the church. They were the ones who were in control. Man, they were so spiritual. They had leather boxes where they would commit not only scriptures to memory, but they would literally wear these leather boxes on their hands and on their wrists and then tape them around their head filled with just the strips of the word. And it would be on their bodies and they would walk around and people would just be like, oh, they're holy. Kind of reminds me of back in the day when we used to put our own list of holiness together and determine whether people were holy by virtue of how long their hair was or how long their skirt was. I'm not coming against living right and holy before God, but there's something to be said for the heart versus the list. The heart. I believe in old time holiness. I believe in living right before God. I believe that the Bible, when it says there'll not be a sin entertained in heaven, there'll not be a sin enter heaven. I believe it when the Bible says He's coming for a church without spot, without wrinkle, without any such thing. And I believe that only comes not through you and I putting a list together. That can't happen through any kind of efforts on our part. That can only happen as we get close enough to Jesus Christ that His righteousness is imparted to us. When we are made righteous and made holy by Jesus, by His sacrifice and by that blood that you were singing about this morning, then you and I can have confidence that we'll stand before God in heaven. It's only then that we have that assurance. Jesus was made to feel unwelcome, made to feel unrighteous, made to feel ashamed and even angry, and made to feel sad because this was the church that was looking for Him. And I want us to be careful this morning that we don't become that kind of church. People ought not to be hurt, wounded, rejected, scorned, talked about, gossiped about, not in God's house. Thankfully, I don't have a story to tell or I don't have an axe to grind. But I would say this, we look at the two. Because on the other side of the coin, Jesus made mention of the publican who was standing afar off of the Cleveland. It says that he had his head down. And well, we know who the publicans were. They were the tax collectors. They were the folks who were always hated. They were betrayers of Israel. They were the ones who collected the taxes and worked for the Roman government. They were the ones who had literally betrayed the children of Israel. They were hated. They were despised. They were outcasts. They would welcome them into the church to pray, but they weren't allowed to be a part of their functions or their social life. They were outcasts. And here's this publican standing back here. He knows. He says, man, I'm a sinner. I'm publican. I'm a tax collector. I've been involved in the greed and the dishonesty. And he's got his head down so low, he can't even lift it up. And he's like, oh God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And Jesus pointed it out that the spiritual guy over here was talking about how he ain't like that guy over here. But Jesus was making it really clear. And he always has done this. He always says, you know, it's always so clear with Jesus. He's always going to go a different direction because we are so conditioned to move in the natural, and God only moves in the supernatural. So that's why his ways are not always our ways. I preached Wednesday night and I said his ways are not always our ways, but his ways are always right. And he will always work the opposite of what man will do, not because he's on some kind of an ego trip and he doesn't want you guys to figure things out ahead of time or any of us to figure out his plan. It's that he wants it always to be clear. Your help comes from the Lord. He's the giver of life. He's the giver of strength. And as long as we keep that focus, when that enemy comes in like a flood, that's the standard that's lifted up against him. The truth of God's spirit and power that's at work in our lives to bring redemption. We have to keep our minds centered on that. The Bible talks about keeping our eyes on the prize, the high calling of Christ Jesus, making sure we don't look to the left and to the right. The Bible taught us not to lean on the arm of flesh. Why is that? Because every time you and I start to thinking that we're smart enough, that we're big enough, that we're powerful enough, that we've done enough, then we start thinking we're all that. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, we get a little too highfalutin. Somebody say amen. And when we get in a place where we're feeling like we're better than everybody else, we're more spiritual than everybody else, let me just give you a clue. The day you start talking about how unspiritual everybody else is and how spiritual you are, how you are given just special revelations and God just talks to you, and too bad he doesn't talk to the preacher. Too bad he don't talk to all them other people out there. But boy, he sure talks to me. The moment you start getting that kind of thoughts inside your head, I want you to go back to the story here and get on your face and get humble before God, because the best you'll ever get from the Lord is a big, big, wonderful light coming to you in inspiration because you have humbled yourself and given yourself to him. How many of you know we're nothing without Jesus? We're nothing without the touch of God on our lives. You're nothing. God doesn't promote. He doesn't want anything to do with arrogance and conceit. He said to these, you know what he said? If you notice in that scripture there, he said, and the Pharisee, the spiritual one, the holy one, the guy that's got it all together, says, and he began to pray to himself. Did you catch that? Praying to himself. He was just wanting to hear himself talk. He didn't go to pray to God. He was going to tell God, Lord, this is what I am. This is who I am. This is me. I'm not like them. And Jesus was pointing out that this was not him. He said, that guy walked away with nothing. Although, he walked away happy. When he got done with his big, long prayer, he walked out of there right past the publican, went home, had lunch, made a couple of calls, made some plans to have a committee meeting, and he just thought he was all that. Lived his life, Brian, thinking, I am blessed, I am spiritual, I am God's special man, walking right past the hurting, right past the publicans, right past all the sinners. Let me just tell you something. I pray every day God sends us the lowest in their hearts, the broken, the bruised, and the battered. I pray all the time that God sends us sinners. I pray he sends us the meanest, rottenest sinners you've ever seen in your life. Well, Brother Ray, you better not be praying that. I won't sit next to him on the pew. It's all right, you sit over there. We'll mark out a place just for you Pharisees. Jesus was never afraid to be found eating with the sinners. He was never afraid to be found doing good on the Sabbath. He came here to tell the church, y'all got it wrong. He came here with a message. He's looking, they're ungrateful. They're not worshiping. They're not looking for him. They don't recognize him. He could have stepped up in front of all of them, cracked some lightning in the sky and said, I am Jesus. I'm the Son of God. I am here on a mission and you better bow right now. He could have done anything he wanted. But instead, he was grieved in his heart with a broken heart as he looked at the church that was still looking for him. Today, they're still at the Wailing Wall praying for the Messiah to come. 2,000 years has went by and they're still praying for the Messiah. Oh, he's coming, all right. He's coming very soon. And I'm going to see the King in all of his glory. And I'm going to know him. And I'm going to sense him. And I'm going to hear him call my name. And I'm going to look into his eyes and I'm going to see him for myself. I can't hardly wait for that time. I can't wait until we are standing on the brinks of glory. I can't wait until all of our schedules have had to die. I can't wait until all of our jobs are vacant. I can't wait until we're marching right down the streets of glory and the angels are standing off to the side as we're marching towards the throne. I can't wait until I hear names being called and I'm getting closer and closer and he calls my name. I can't wait to see my loved ones. I can't wait to see a mama that I've been missing now for about 8 months. I can't wait to see all the prophets of old, but I cannot wait until the battle is over and won. And with Joshua and with David and with Moses and with Abraham and good old Ruth, I can stand next to all of them and I can say, I overcame by the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. He is my salvation and my King. Oh, hallelujah. I can't wait until we're standing there. I've got my heart set on heaven. I'm homesick to go. I heard people say, oh, I just can't wait. I'm heartsick to go. I'm homesick for heaven. And when I was a young man, I thought, man, I got everything in the world to live for. What do you want to go so early for? Man, you know, do they play Gilligan up there? I remember one time I went to my mom. I was serious. Mom, I got a question. She said, what is it, baby? And I said, is there Gilligan's Island in heaven? She went, oh, no, silly. And I went back to my room, and I was like, no Gilligan's Island in heaven? Skipper! I was like, no way. Well, I don't want to go. Kid, immaturity. But as I've been able to get mature, and as I've went through one storm after another, and I've went through trials, and I've climbed up mountains and found myself coming down from them with victory in my back pocket, I'll tell you, I've got a homesick feeling this morning. I've got a homesick feeling for glory. And if you've ever been wounded or hurt by the old Pharisees of the modern day church, I apologize. I'm sorry. As for one member of this church, I'm going to tell you, we're going to do everything in our power to move that kind of an attitude and that kind of a thing out of our church. Jesus was against it and I'm against it. I want you to know you're welcome here. You're welcome here. If you're a sinner, you're welcome here. Now granted, we're not going to let you stay like you are. The Bible talks about you becoming a brand new creature in Christ Jesus. I'm talking about power that changes you from who you were to a brand new creature in Christ. I'm talking about a deliverance from your past life. I'm talking about healing over hurts that you've had in your life. I'm talking about victory. I'm talking about dancing and shouting and praising God and living to your potential. I don't want you to come and just live like you did before. And well, we're just going to love you and condone everything you're into. No, man, we're going to preach this gospel to you because everywhere Jesus went. Did you notice? He never left anybody like they were. Every time he walked away from them, they were doing something like this, or they were dancing, or they were running. They were healed completely. And by the way, I just thought about that. I'm doing a whole lot of moving. I'm still healed. One whole week, and I'm healed this morning. I praise him, and I thank him. Stand with me this morning. I praise him, and I thank him. He is an awesome and a mighty God. The Bible talks about all like sheep, we've all gone astray. But oh, Jesus, he's making it clear here. He says, there's a way you ought to go to church. You ought to go to church like the publican. Jesus was saying he got more. Was it because he was bad? No. It was because in his heart, he was repentant. The only difference between him and that old Pharisee, Brother Ray Downs, was repentance. A change. He knew what he was without Jesus. This Pharisee hadn't got the message yet. So you see, it comes back to this. It don't matter whether you're fourth generation Church of God or not. It don't matter whether you've been in the way 50 years. Maybe it's time to get out of the way. Doesn't matter if you read and you pray and you pay and you do all these things. If the heart's not in it, then it's a waste. It's a gift. Thank you very much. But it's not what he's talking about. You might leave justified in yourself. But there's another scripture in the Bible that says, when Jesus is talking and he says, many will come to me in that day. And they'll say, but Lord, I was a Sunday school teacher. Lord, I cast out devils in your name. I did all these great works in your name. Lord, I did all these things. And Jesus is still going to be looking. I mean, I think it goes back to this whole story here. He's going to look at him. He's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Because it's not about what you do. It's about who he is and what he becomes to you. And when he changes your life, then you're a believer. And whether or not you were a Pharisee or a publican, after the heart has been changed, you belong to him. And you're as sure for heaven, you're as sure for heaven as if you were already there. Would you bow your heads with us this morning? This is probably the most important part of this service. Lord Jesus, your mission, you not only were seeking the lost, as the Bible says, to seek and to save that which was lost, and not only to destroy the works of the enemy, but Lord, in all of that mix was the church. The church that nailed you to the cross. The church that persecuted you, rejected you. When it talks about the rejection, that you were despised and smitten. When it talks about these things, it wasn't talking about the world. It's talking about your church. Lord, may the church repent today. May we as believers stand up and declare that'll not be a part of this body. It'll not be a part of who we are, as the Lord is trusting us and sending us people, sending us folks that are broken and bruised, people that need Jesus, as he's trusting them to send them to this lighthouse. God, may we forever be fine-tuning our love and our heart for you. May we ever be repenting and humble. May we be broken before you. God, there's no big eyes here. There's nobody that's got an important position over anybody else. Lord, we're all in this as the body of Christ, with you as the chief cornerstone. Touch our hearts today. Lord, there are different kinds of sheep here today. There's the lost sheep, people that are going to get saved today. There's wounded sheep, people that have been wounded by the same church that hurts you. Wounded with their mouth, ruined with their gossip, ruined with their judgments, declaring who's acceptable and who's not, who's in and who's out. Ilabasoto ramayadai. And then there's the sheep of the household of the faith of God. The sheep, the true disciples, the true body. Lord, as we bind together in the power of your name, we can conquer every enemy. As we become real, as we lay aside every weight and the hindrances that so easily beset us, as we run this race, we keep the faith, we hold fast, we finish our course. There's victory over that finish line. So touch the people today. And I appeal, Lord, to the lost sheep today. Maybe they've never heard from a pulpit in a church somebody actually repenting over the people, that the hypocrites that have hurt them. But I do, Lord, I repent for those that have misused and abused their rights and privileges as a child of God. For those who have somehow been trapped in the devil's lies and schemes and become hypocrites. But Lord, I pray that even their hearts you will change, that you'll touch them even today, rescue them, rescue us. For I believe, Lord, the countdown is on. And just like it's exciting at times to watch in New York City, at New York Times, the ball getting ready to drop right at midnight on a brand new year. I sense the cheering and the roaring and the rustling of heaven as the countdown is getting close, and those closest to you, they realize and they know something is happening. Something is stirring. The angels are getting in armies and getting ready, and there's all kinds of rehearsals going on for a marriage supper. There's all kinds of activity going on. Lord, as they sense and they know that something is changing, something is about to happen, may it be said of this church that we're looking, longing to the eastern sky, listening for the trump of God, for we know that you're coming soon. And may that change us today. So we once again, through your word, look into your eyes and hear your voice. We love you, Jesus, and we need you. We need you, Lord. With your heads continue to stay bowed, I would appeal just a moment to those lost sheep in here today. And when we say lost sheep, you're without Jesus. Man, maybe everything's went wrong. You've struggled, you fought, the family's falling apart, the job is not working out. I'm telling you, the Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledge him and he'll direct your path. He promises all through his word that he will take care of you. He will lead you and guide you. It won't always be your way. Gideon had 32,000 men, and God said, no, we're going to do it with 300. God won't do it your way, but he'll always do it right. And in the end, you'll always say thank you. You'll always see a great work. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, is there anyone today that would say, preacher, I want to get right with God. I want to be right with him. I want to things in my life to get squared away. I want to know that I'm ready. I don't want to be one of these confused people that is involved in all the schemes of the earth. I want to be the child of God that I'm called to be and invited to be by the Holy Spirit today. Would you just lift your hand up right where you are? There's one. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? There's another. Is there anyone else? People just, there's another one. Is there anyone else? I want to get right with God. I just want things to be right. I may have been in the church my whole life. I just want things to be right. I want to know that I'm on the firing line. I want to know that I'm going to hear those words, well done. Is there anyone else? That's me, preacher. There's another one. I tell you what, I've been lifting my hand all morning because I want to make sure that he knows my heart. Oh, I want to see him look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Do you want to see him this morning? Congregation, if you would, I'd like you to help me. We're going to pray right now. We're going to ask everyone in just a moment to come forward for a closing prayer. But before we even move, several have lifted their hands saying, you know what, Pastor, I want to pray. I just want God to know where my heart is. I want to be an open book to him. So we're not going to move. We're going to pray right now. And then we're all going to come forward and be dismissed together. But would you pray this with me, everybody? Let's help sinners come to Jesus today. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. I accept you as the Lord of my life. I aim to serve you the rest of my life. I believe you came to this earth. You went to the cross. You died and you rose again. And you did that for me. So according to your word, I profess you as my Savior. And I believe you in my heart. So I'm saved. I'm saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God.